long history. And so with the help of Susan, we've been able to gather some of our historical items and place it out there in the archives. And so if you would like to take a look at that, feel free to just, you know, scan through all the documents and pictures and everything that's out there. Okay, so just like I said, a reflection and a celebration of our history here at our church. We've been around since 1857. Not only that, I also want us to know that we will be celebrating Eli's birthday this coming Saturday at Oliver's Community Park. So that's about 35 miles south of here. And so for those of you who can make it, please do join us. Okay. And his birthday is actually on May 9th, but you know, we didn't have the time to celebrate May 9th, so we scheduled him for today, which he was very, very upset with, you know, on the 9th. He was very upset. And he didn't get any presents on that day. But we bought a little cake on that day, so we just we did a quick little celebration for him with the official party where all his cousins and friends and everybody's going to come over. We'll be here this coming Saturday at Oliver's Community Park. So I do invite all of you to join us on that day. And at this time, I'll invite anybody else who has any other announcements to make at this time.
Can you hear me? Yes? Okay. Next Wednesday, Cooperating Christian Churches is having their annual meeting here in the sanctuary right after dinner at 6. And we will be distributing the money that night that was made on the Hunger Walk. It was not nearly as much as it has been in years past, but we'll be giving that out. We will be having a hymn sing, and we will have a joyous time together. And any of you that can come, I hope you will. And if you do come, it would be nice if you would bring some cookies or finger food so we can have a little get-together in the sanctuary afterwards. That's next Wednesday night.
Thank you.
Yesterday, I attended the district conference in Loomis, and the thing of note that happened there, a new district union was formed. And this appears to me to be predominantly for financial reasons, but I put a couple of copies of the bylaws of this union in the office. Feel free to take a look at those. If you have any questions, I will try to answer them. The other thing of note is the annual conference is coming up in a little less than a month. They have about 25 issues that will be voted on at the conference. I have put some literature on these issues in the office as well, and I would appreciate it.
Okay, if you're able to, please stand with me and join me for the call to worship that is in your bulletin. The call to worship. What would God have us do? Lord, guide our lives and our service. Help us, Lord, to look beyond words. Open our hearts and our spirits this day to receive your guidance. Come, let us worship God with thanksgiving for gifts of ministry. Let us praise God. Please turn your hymnals to page 399 of the red hymnal. Take my life and let it be. Thank you so much for this day as we reflect upon the history of our church and the blessings that you've given us throughout since 1857 for the past 162 years of service. We ask that you bless us continuously as we continue on this journey of faith with you as we move forward, that you will continue to be with us and continue to be our guide, provide us the wisdom to be able to lead this church for another 162 years. And so, Father, today as we worship, Holy Spirit to be among all of us. Lift up our voices to glorify you today. And so we pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, I'd like to invite the choir.
just been made king after Solomon's death. Jeroboam, a powerful leader, had just come back from exile in Egypt, wanting to serve Rehoboam if his people were treated less harshly. Hear the word of God. 3 days later, Jeroboam and all the people returned to Rehoboam, as the king had said, "Come back to me in 3 days." The king answered the people harshly, rejecting the advice given him by the elders. He followed the advice of the young men and said, "My father made your yoke heavy. I will make it even heavier. My father scorched you with whips. I will scourge you with scorpion." So the king did not listen to the people, for this turn of events was from the Lord, to fulfill the word the Lord had spoken to Jeroboam, son of Nebat, through Ahijah, the Silonite. When all Israel saw that the king refused to listen to them, they answered the king, "What share do we have in David? What part in Jesse's son? To your tents, Israel. Look after your own house, David." So the Israelites went home. But as for the Israelites who were living in the towns of Judah, Rehoboam still ruled over them. The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. We're going to have children time. I'm going to have to start adding that to our board. So, come up here. All right. Scar, okay? So Scar tried to take over the kingdom, right? Simba? Jeremy. I want to take us to one of the scenes in that movie where Simba met the monkey. The monkey's name was Rikishi, right? Rikishi. And so Simba has been away for a very, very, very long time. And he's been out there just hanging out with Timon and Pumbaa. So he's forgotten who he was. Until Rikishi discovered him. Rikishi hit him across the head, right? And after Rikishi took him, to the pond here, a reflection of his father in that pond, and then all of a sudden his father appeared in the clouds, right? You ever remember that scene? And then his father said to him, "You have forgotten who you are, because you have forgotten who I am." Right? That's one of the things that I just want to share with us today, is that as Christians, we must never forget who our father is. As Christians, we must never forget who God is. Because if we forget who God is, always remember, always remember. Father, we come before you, Father. We lift up the three children here before us to you. We ask that you be with them. Empower them throughout their lives, Father, to be close to you. Allow them to serve you throughout their lives. We lift them up to you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. See you guys next week. Okay, it's time for us to share our voice.
I'd like to thank everyone who's been praying for my mom, Chris Barnes. She's in San Diego, and she just had cancer surgery, a double mastectomy, and it's been quite an adjustment for her, and it's been a little hard on my sister and myself, too. So thank you for praying for us. I would like prayers for my brother Olaf. I spoke with him this week, and some unexpected things have been happening to him. He went to the doctor, and more tests to come. So please keep him in your prayers.
Is that the one that lives in Michigan? Father, we humble our hearts before you. Every time we come before you, we ask that you continue to remind us of who you are. That you are indeed a perfect, holy, righteous God. Filled with love, filled with worship, filled with grace. As we continue to bow our heads before you, we know that you are faithful. Even though many times we may not be as faithful as we need to be to you. Many times we fail in our own lives, Father. We are so grateful that you are God with great, great mercy. And that you continue to forgive us and continue to hold on to us even when we cannot hold on to you. Even when our strength is gone, our weakest moments, you are the one that provides the strength to keep us moving forward. And so, Father, today, as we pray, we ask that you be with all. We ask that you continue to guide and continue to bless him as he goes out to get these tests done. We ask that you give him the strength and the courage as he goes through this difficult time. We also want to ask that you be with the entire family. Comfort them through this time. We pray for the good news, Father. Not only that, we also thank you so much for Chris. We pray for her as she is in San Diego battling her illnesses. The surgery that she went through, from what we heard, was a successful surgery. So we pray for her. We're so thankful for that. We ask for your comfort to also be upon their family at all times. You are the God that can restore us, that can restore our faith, that can restore our health. And so in that is where we put our faith in. Even when things seem to be so impossible through you, you know that all things. When your son walked on this earth, he healed the blind. And so with that, we call upon his name. We pray for all of us here in this room. We pray for those who are battling their own illnesses. We trust that you will restore them, their health, that you will heal them. We pray for our community. We pray
pray for our country. We pray for this earth that belongs to you. We pray that your power, that your glory will shine upon every single leader of every single nation. We pray that you will continue to bless and continue to guide us. And so together as your children, together as your church here, we gather with brothers and sisters to pray the prayer of your Son, Jesus Christ, Thomas, our Father, the Lord, our King. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory of the Lord. Amen. Please stand if you're able to. Turn your minds to page 444. Page 444. O young. Thank you. overseer is to be above reproach, faithful to his wife, temperate, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not given to drunkenness, not violent but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. He must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him, and he must do so in a manner worthy of full respect. If anyone does not know how to manage his own family, how can he take care of God's church? He must not be a recent convert, or he may become conceited and fall under the same judgment as the devil. He must always have a good reputation with outsiders, so that he will not fall into disgrace and into the devil's trap. In the same way, deacons are to be worthy of respect, sincere, not indulging in much wine, and not pursuing dishonest gain. They must keep hold of the deep truths of the faith with a clear conscience. They must first be tested, and then if there is nothing against them, let them serve as deacons. In the same way, the women are to be worthy of respect, not malicious talkers, but temperate and trustworthy in everything. A deacon must be faithful to his wife and must manage his children and his household well. Those who have served well gain an excellent standing and great assurance in their faith in Christ Jesus. The word of God for the people of God.
We've been doing ministry here at Oroville since 1857 as a church. Since 1857. And so our church started with a pastor by the name of Pastor J.R. Tansley. And it started in 1857, however, it wasn't incorporated until May of 1878. And then on April 4th of 1879, we began the building of our first church building, which was completed in 1883, and it was located at the northeast corner of Byrd and also Lincoln. And then in 1909, as a congregation grew, a newer and much larger church was built at Robinson and Lincoln Streets, and the church building was completed for $22,000 at that time. $22,000, and it was dedicated in March of 1911. February of 1965, that's when we started building our current church here. A few months later, the old church on Robinson and Lincoln was torn down. And at the time it was torn down, it was 55 years old. The very first service at our current church here was held on September 26, 1965. For over the past 162 years, we have had more than 50 pastors serving our church. More than 50 pastors. You know, as we reflect upon the past, as we reflect upon our history, we see all the many, many great blessings that God has truly given us here at our church. Blessing us throughout these years, through the 162 years of service here in this community. There's a point in time in which our church, there are so many members here in our church that there's not enough seats for everybody. But over the years, you know, the membership has declined. And yet one of the things that we as the church need to come and think about is, as we reflect upon our history, is how do we move forward? Our leaders of the past, such as J.R. Tansley, our leaders of the past, us and started our church, organized our church. All the things, all the sacrifices that they have given us to allow our church to be around for the past 162 years. Now the challenge is for us, will we be able to keep our church going for another 162 years? That's a big challenge. That's a big challenge for us. There's a saying in terms of leadership that when the fish stinks, it stinks from the head down. of the things that I observe is this, that when the leadership gets along, everybody else gets along. When the leadership are not fighting against each other, the church is not fighting against each other. But when I become part of a church that where the leadership is constantly fighting each other, when the leadership is divided, the church also becomes divided. When the leadership is fighting, the church starts fighting against each other because everybody starts taking sides. I'm on this leader's side, or I agree with this leader, I agree with that leader, and then the fights start. I've been a part of a church in the past where the pastor and the lay leader would fight publicly during worship service. They would fight, you know, they would go up there, they would have to hit each other's face. But you know exactly who we're talking about. And things such as this, let us realize, make us realize that one of the most about being a church is that we need to have our own leaders. As we move forward and try to set our goal, to try to set our vision to move our church and continuing to serve in our community for the next 162 years, we need to come to ask ourselves what kind of spiritual leadership must we have in our church? How can we transform this community? How can we go about to accomplish this mission that Jesus Christ has given us to transform this world for Jesus Christ? But not that we're just doing transforming this world with Jesus Christ, but that we are transforming this world with Jesus Christ. And I want to use that word "with" here is because the only way the world can be able to do anything is if we continue to walk with Christ. If we continue to walk with Jesus Christ. Because we can't do anything for him if we're separated from him. We can't do anything, we can't transform this world for him if we're not walking with him. And so it's very, very important. It's very, very important that we walk with Jesus Christ as the church, especially as leaders of the church. There is no organization out there that would just put any kind of person in the leadership role. Oftentimes churches, we just throw anybody into leadership role. We don't really think about the impact of which that person may have on the church. We see in the passage in 1 Kings, when King Solomon had just passed away and his son, Rehoboam, became king. That was the start of the division of the kingdom of Israel. Because Rehoboam wasn't a good king. He didn't listen to the people. He did things his own way. He did not listen to the advice of the elders. But he went his own way. And because of him, the kingdom of Israel became divided, the north and the south. And so we see the effects of leadership here in the scriptures, saying that when we don't think about what types of leaders are in place, when we don't really focus on these things, that we just put anybody in leadership roles, that we can cause division in an entire nation, and also within the church. And the Apostle Paul, when he wrote the letter to Timothy, here in 1 Timothy chapter 3, he really wanted to emphasize on this because he was so worried about the church at that time. He was so worried that this new church rising up, that they were just going to start throwing people into all these leadership roles. He knew nothing about the church. All these people, all these newcomers who were not yet even matured in their faith, and many, many of them in the church who were not even walking. And so Paul was very careful in his instructions to young Timothy as to how he can go about selecting leaders for the church that will keep the church going, that will keep the church together. And based upon these instructions, the church has used these instructions in 1 Timothy for the past 2,000 years. And has kept the church going for the past 2,000 years. And so, how can we as young as members of this church, how can we keep our church going? Well, the first thing we need to realize here, as the Apostle Paul says, he says in verse 1 that this is a trustworthy saying. If anyone sets his heart on being an overseer, he desires a noble task. I want us to highlight that word, noble task. A lot of times we don't see the task that we do in the church as something that is noble, as something that is important, as something that is valuable. And so many times we see our duties in the church as something that we do simply as a hobby, something that we simply do on the weekend, something that we don't simply do whenever we have free time. We don't really sacrifice anything for it many times. We're leaders in the church, but we really don't, you know, make time for it. We only do it whenever it's convenient for us. And what the Apostle Paul is saying here is that this is not something that we do only when it's convenient for us, but that this is something that we must do because it's something that is so, so important, is to serve within the church. Because as Christians, this is what we believe. This is what we believe. We are not doing anything. The work that we are doing is not simply for this life. But the work that we are doing in the church, the services that we are given, it is about eternity. We are working with people, we are saving their souls, we are saving them for all of eternity. Many of the things that we do are simply for this lifetime. You know, my job that I do on from Monday through Friday, something that I do for this lifetime. But the things that I do for God is something that lasts forever. That it is something that is for eternity. That's how important. That's how important it is. That's how essential it is for us to see this thing that we do here in the church as something that is gold, something that is sold. If we don't believe in that eternity, that view of eternity, if we don't see that view of eternity, it's hard for us to even place any kind of importance on the things that we do here today. We have to have that view for eternity. Forbes says this, one of the articles that they wrote, says that in order for us to really move forward, in order for us to really change the culture and move forward, it all starts with inspiring a shift in mindset and moving away from the sentiment of that's how things have been done around here to a new mindset, to a new mentality that says this is how we are going to be thinking and this is how we are going to act from now on. And so in order for people to move forward, in order for leaders to lead a change in mentality needs to take place. A shift in our mindset needs to take place. The question that we should not be focusing on so much is that, you know, what have we been doing for the past 162 years? But the thing that we need to focus on is how, starting today, how can we start to think about this new generation? How do we start to think about this new culture that we are living in? How can we become a part of this new culture, of this new generation? How can we take the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ to this new culture that we live in? We are not living in the same culture. We're not living in the same time that J.R. Tanzi and them lived in back in the 1800s. It's not the same time. We are living in a very different time. Maybe in the past, Christianity had a great influence on our culture, on our society. Today, we are living in a time in which Christianity is losing its influence in our culture. We need to start thinking about how we can move forward with this. And the way that we think about this is not to change the message of the gospel, but how to apply the gospel. How to apply the gospel to our new generation, into the time that we are living in. To be a leader that can transform the world with Christ, to be a spiritual leader, what we must must be one to be pushed outside of our very own comfort zone. And many times the reason why we're not able to serve God with all of our hearts, we're not able to change, we're not able to transform the world is because we like to stay within our own comfort zone. We like to do the things that we've been doing for the past 162 years. But we need to start asking ourselves, how can I be encouraged to move out of my comfort zone and to start doing ministry within the culture that I am in? It's very different. Ministry is very different in each culture. To do ministry in the Hmong culture is very different than to do ministry in the Anglo culture. To do ministry in the Hispanic culture is very different than doing ministry in the Hmong culture. And so each culture has their own needs. How do we go about to bring the gospel to our culture, the culture that we are living in today, to the society that we are living in today? And the first thing we need to understand is we need to know who we are. We need to know who we are as Christians. When we see Jesus Christ, we see that even those who don't believe in Jesus, even those, you know, the secular world, one thing that they have to commit to, even if they don't believe that Christ is the Son of God, they have to admit to that Jesus Christ is one of the most influential leaders of all time. For the past 2,000 years, the message of Jesus Christ continues to go on. People continue to follow Jesus Christ, even after he's been dead for 2,000 years. Even for those who don't believe that he resurrected from the dead, it doesn't matter. But they have to admit that after 2,000 years of this past, the passing of Jesus Christ, that people are still following. And so we see that Jesus Christ throughout history is one of the most influential leaders. And yet, he knew exactly who he was. He says in John chapter 6, verse 35, he says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. In John chapter 8, verse 12, he says, I am the light of the world. In John chapter 10, verse 9, he says, I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. John chapter 10, verse 11, he says, I am the good shepherd. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 1, the Apostle Paul himself also identified who he was. You see, the Apostle Paul, he was able to be successful in his ministry as the first missionary to the Gentiles is because he also understood who he was. And he said, in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 1, he says, I am called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus. By the will of God. And so these men, the reason why they were able to impact the world for 2,000 years is because they were confident and they knew who they were. They knew exactly who they were. And as Christians, many times, you know, over the years, living in a culture that's losing, that we are losing our influence in, many times we have forgotten who we are. Many times we have forgotten who we are as Christians. And so because of that, we have also forgotten who God is. And that's why when I had the children up here, I talked to them a little bit about that scene in the movie Lion King. Because Simba, he was out there, you know, just in the wilderness. And his father finally compared to him. And his father says, Simba, you have forgotten who you are. And Simba says, Father, no, I haven't. I haven't forgotten who I am. And his father says to him, you know what? You have forgotten me. And so that's why you have forgotten. That's one of the things that we need to do as Christians in order for us to continue our service for the next 162 years is to rediscover who God is. One of the biggest errors that we as Christians can do, and this is the reason why we have so many denominations, is because we like to pick certain parts of the Bible to believe. Everybody does that. We like to pick certain parts of God. All denominations do this. That's what we're serving. Some denominations, they want to focus on the holiness of God. Other denominations, they just want to focus on the Holy Spirit. Other denominations, they just want to focus on the Son. Other denominations, they just want to focus on God as well. They don't talk about anything else. And then you go to these churches talking about hell and brimstone and fire and things like that. And we like to focus on little things that appeal to us, but one of the things we need to understand in the Asian culture, in Chinese culture, one of the things that they believe in is that in order for us to have a successful life, is that we need to have a balance. That's what the yin and the yang is. And so in order for us to understand God, in order for us to discover who God is, we need to have a balance. We need to believe in everything God believes, not just only certain parts that appeal to us. And that's the reason why we end up with so many denominations. Because we like to just focus on certain aspects that we want. Positive vision of the church. But to have a balanced view of God is what we need as Christians. We need to discover who God is. That God is love. He is love. He is filled with grace. He is filled with mercy. But he is also someone who will judge the world. He's also God of wrath. He's also God of judgment. That although we are to draw close to him, at the same time, the Bible also tells us that we are to fear him. And so all these things, when they come together, sometimes certain things that we don't like, we push that aside, only to focus on the things. And because of that, we have lost. We have forgotten meaning because we have forgotten others. And so in order for us to continue to do ministry and to continue to have influence here in this community is that we need to discover who God is so that we will know who we are as Christians. We often talk about Jesus that says, do not judge the adultery woman. We often talk about that Jesus. But we forget about Jesus that said to that same woman, go. Very same paragraph. And yet we read the top while we forget about God. We talk about the Jesus that was filled with grace, that healed the lame, healed the weak, healed the blind. But we forget to talk about the Jesus that was flipping chairs in the temple. We need to have a balanced view of who Jesus Christ is. That's the church. Discovery. And who are we in Jesus Christ? We are a child of God. We are a new creation. We have been chosen and appointed by God. We are someone who has been set free. We are someone who has been set free from the bondage of sin. We are the salt and light of this world. We are a dwelling place for the Holy Spirit. Our body is a dwelling place for the Holy Spirit. We are a member of Christ's body, and we have been called to share the gospel and to make disciples. All these comes from the Bible. Teaches us that this is who we are. We cannot forget that we are children of God. We cannot forget that we are a new creation. And when we remember who we are, we will understand what our purpose is as a church. Sometimes, when this past week, I was asked to go and pray for the Hmong veterans of America. They came together to put a little celebration together with the city, with the leaders of Beaver County. And so they asked me to be the pastor to go there and pray for their celebration. These are men that I've known my whole life. I talk to them, I talk to them all the time. I see them in the community. I interact with them a lot. Many times, but all those times that I interacted with them, all those times that I talked to them, one of the things that often escapes my mind is that I often forget all the sacrifices that they gave to me. I often forget that. And on Wednesday when I went there to pray for them, they had all their own uniforms on. And they're sitting there in that room. And the youth council provider spoke to them, and after that they asked the Lord to pray for them. And I stood up and I looked at all those men. All those men who Another thing I want us to understand is that we need to compete to serve. We need to find people to empower the church. We need to develop relationships with the right people. Paul was able to serve because he had the right relationship with the right people. And so we also have to have a system of discipleship to bring up our children and to raise them up to become leaders. So there's so much things that I have here on my notes. I want to be able to go through them all for us here in one day. But I just want to conclude by saying this. In order for us to be leaders that will transform this world, we need to know who we are. We need to know who we are. We need to find our purpose. And to do this, we need to discover who God is. We need to start to serve people and find people to empower. We need to start developing relationships with people who can help us serve. But we need to have we need to come together and have a system of discipleship to raise up leaders in our church. We need to do these things so that we can continue our mission for the next 162 years. Father, we thank you so much for your love. You have blessed us tremendously for this past 162 years of service in this community. We can only ask that you continue to be with us and empower us for the next 162 years as we continue to share the good news and continue to transform this community and serve this community for your sake. So we pray in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's time for us to do our turn. Please remain standing to come to page 571. 571, go.